Hello everybody, thank you for joining us today. I hope all of you are doing well and are taking good care of yourselves and your dear ones. I'm Vanya and I work as the Communications and the Public Engagement Officer at DBT Welcome Trust India Alliance, and I will be your host for today's sessions. Once again, I welcome you all to this virtual event specially designed for veterinary and animal science researchers of NDRI and NBAGR. During this webinar, we will discuss the most important aspects of grants writing, talk about the various research funding programs of DBT Welcome Trust India Alliance, and also try to learn about the needs of the veterinary and animal science research community in India. On the onset, I would like to thank Director NDRI for giving us this opportunity to meet you all, and Dr. Ashok Mahanty for his help in planning out this event and reaching out to you people. Before we get on with the sessions, I would very briefly like to introduce the organization that I represent, DBT Welcome Trust India Alliance. India Alliance is a public charity that's registered in India and that funds research and research in health and biomedical sciences in India. India Alliance invests in transformative ideas, supportive research ecosystems to advance discovery and innovation to improve health and well-being. It is funded by Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, and by Wellcome Trust UK. Apart from funding research, we also fund various programs that promote national and international collaborations, workshops for professional skill building and capacity building in the research ecosystem, and interventions to strengthen the overall Indian research ecosystem. We are also committed to making science more accessible, and we facilitate different public engagement programs with science in India. To help us all better navigate the console of the webinar and to participate in the webinar better, in a more engaged way, I would like to share a few housekeeping tips before we start. Can I have the next slide, please? Yeah, so during the session, the video and the microphone of all attendees will remain switched off. But you can leave your questions for the speakers anytime during the webinar in the question box. You can see on the screen where the question box is. You can just type your questions in that box. Also, during the question answer session, you can raise your electronic hand and we can unmute you, and you can then ask your question or share your comment and feedback with us. This webinar is being recorded and will be soon posted on India Alliance's YouTube channel. In case the webinar ends abruptly due to any technical glitch, please join back the webinar using the original registration link that you received on your email IDs. Please note that we will also be issuing an e-certificate for participation in these sessions. This will be shared with the participants who attend the entire event and also submit the post-event survey form. And if you plan to share any highlights from these sessions on your social media accounts, please feel free to tag us. You will find our social media details at the bottom of the slide that's on your screen. Next slide, please. So for today's event, we have two sessions planned. The session one will focus on both the fundamentals as well as the more advanced aspects of grants writing. In session two, we will discuss the various funding opportunities that India Alliance provides for researchers in India. But before we can begin session one, I would all like to request you all to participate in a quick poll. Very soon you will see a poll on your screen. I request you to please answer this poll. Yeah, few more seconds. So, so we have a very mixed bag of audience here, because 28% say that they have average skill, and I think 28% say that they would like to learn more. They have slight knowledge, and less than 50% of our audience say that they are competent in writing grants proposals. So I think all of you here will agree with me that it's not just enough to have a good research question. It's equally important to have a good research plan and to be able to communicate that plan when you are applying for research funds and research grants. And this is exactly why grants writing is such an important skill that researchers must acquire to be able to secure funding for their work. And to discuss these very aspects, without further delay, I would like to introduce our first speaker and dive straight into the session. Please meet Dr. Vasavaraj Sajjanar, who is a scientist at Division of Veterinary Biotechnology, Indian Veterinary Research Institute, IVRI. And he's also an early career fellow of India Alliance. Dr. Sajjanar has done his PhD from IVRI, and he then subsequently joined ARS service of ICR in 2011. In the initial years of his career, he was at National Institute of Abiotic Stress Management, Maharashtra, and later shifted to IVRI. He has done his postdoctoral training at Leibniz Institute of Farm Animal Biology, Germany. His research interests include epigenetic mechanisms in virus host and stress immune interactions. He was also awarded with the Overseas Postdoctoral Fellowship of DST. Welcome, Dr. Sajjanar. The floor is all yours.
And thank you very much, Banya, for a very nice introduction. In the next couple of minutes, I will be sharing some of the key elements of effective grant writing and also my perspectives on India Alliance fellowships. So just to begin, I would like to mention here that most of my talking points will be relevant for early career researchers who have recently completed their PhD or they're in the early part of their postdoctoral programs. So the talk is organized in four sections. In the first section, we will see how we can plan and write a research proposal. And in the second section, we will see how we present ourselves as a person and also justify our research proposal. And in the third section, we will see how what are the resources available for preparing a grant application. And in the last section, I would like to I will try to share some of my personal experiences when I applied for this India Alliance Early Career Fellowship. So coming to understand the grant application itself, why it is always difficult to obtain grants or fellowships? So the most obvious reason, as we all know, is there is a huge competition for prestigious grants. But apart from this reason, one more reason, which is also very crucial as an applicant, we should know that there is a differences in the perception, especially in the funding agency, for the both proposal as well as the person or applicant. So as an applicant, we should walk an extra mile and try to convince the funding agency that the research proposal which we are proposing is important as well as a novel and worth pursuing. At the same time, we should also convince the funding agency that we are the right person and at the right place with enough motivation to take up this research problem. So since the funding agency always looks for both research proposal and applicant, our grant application should be a cogent, well-supported argument. So that can reduce this perception gap and convert our grant application into a grant award. So there are two aspects, very important aspects of writing any grant application. Then that is first is adequate planning, and then second one is effective writing. Coming to what all is included in adequate planning for a research proposal. So it involves persistent working on different aspects of the proposal, starting from selecting a proper research area or topic, and understanding a broader or long-term research goal of that topic, and identifying key research questions, and also framing a good research hypothesis, and also designing experimental plans, and finally to give a thought about what are all the major resources required to take up the experimental plans. So we will take each of these sections briefly. So starting with selecting a research topic, as we can see, most of the early career researchers like me, we tend to take up our PhD topic or whatever recently completed postdoctoral project as a research topic. But one should be open to any topic in which they are genuinely interested. So one of the important thing is, for example, the India Alliance has no restriction on type of research area. So it funds most of the basic biomedical problems. And I would like to mention some of our veterinary and animal science topics are also important for part of life science problems. And we can say that some of our problems are also very significant and have an economic importance, since they mostly deal with the field problems of our animal agriculture, and there is a more chances of also getting the India Alliance funding for such research area. So coming to understand the broader research goals or long-term research goals, so it's very important to know the long-term research goals. For this, one should have a better understanding of current advancements in the field. So as we know, the science is moving at a very greater speed, and most of the long-term research goals can turn out to be a major topic itself. For example, if I want to give an example, so the stem cell research area, which had harnessing the stem cells for therapeutics as a long-term research goal. But nowadays, the stem cell therapy or regenerative medicine itself has turned out into a major topic. So to understand the long-term research goals, extensive reading is the key, and also discussing with some of the experts in the field, and including your mentors and supervisors, is also very essential. So mentioning a long-term research goal in your grant application is also crucial, because it not only reflects the significance of the research area which you are taking up, but also it will give a future direction in which you are heading. So one should always have an understanding of long-term research goal. So coming to the third part of the research proposal, that is identifying a key research questions. These are the key research questions, or nothing but they exactly reflect what the investigator want to do exactly. So India Alliance application also calls for a separate section where the applicant is asked to mention some of the key research questions. So further, these research questions should not be vague. So they should be stated with some of the criteria. For example, the research question should be focused and concise, meaning that either these questions should be on a single aspect of a problem or very closely related aspects. And also, they should be stated in a limited number of words. At the same time, the second criteria is they should be researchable, in the sense that so they can be answerable with some of the scientific data. And the third criteria is the question should be feasible and attainable with the available time and resources. They should be answerable, in the sense that within the time frame and the resources, they should be achievable. And the other thing is the timeliness, in the sense the research questions should address the current concerns and also give us some future directions. So one should develop a key research questions based on these criteria. Coming to the fourth part, that is a research hypothesis. So framing a research hypothesis is nothing but giving a probable answer to a research question. So the applicant should be able to put some of the probable answer to his own research questions. So it is said that without hypothesis, the research can be an aimless search. So even though some of the research hypothesis proved to be false, but still they are valuable. Again, the research hypothesis should not be vague, and they should also, one should keep in mind some of the criteria or formula to state a research hypothesis. For example, here it is stated here that the hypothesis should be a tentative statement that can be testable with two or more variables. So we all know how the scientific hypothesis can be converted into a statistical hypothesis of null and alternative type for its testing. So coming to the next session, next section of hypothesis testing and power calculation. So to establish the results of results credibility and also reliability, so hypothesis testing and power calculation are very important. Nowadays, the funding agency have a concern on the reliability of results from the funded projects. So our application should address this aspect. One should also know how I am testing my research question, whether I am taking care of any possible risks of false representation and avoiding the random sample error. So these questions should be always kept in mind. Seeing here, we know that any significant results we get, it depends upon the effect size, variability, and sample size. So as an investigator in a particular field, we should know in beforehand what is the effect size and variability we are targeting. In the sense, what is the minimum smallest effect size that is practically meaningful, and what is the variability in the population? To just give an example, if I have a hypothesis of like a supplement increase the milk yield in dairy cattle of population X, so what is the effect size? What is the increase in the milk yield which I am targeting, whether it's a 2 liter or 3 liter, and also the variability in the population, that is the variability of milk yield in that population. So considering these effect size and variability, the sample size can be calculated with the help of power calculation. So in this direction, consulting a statistician is also crucial. So the India Alliance application guidelines also mentions that the experimental design should be supported with the proper power calculation and sample size. So including this hypothesis testing and power calculation will also reflect the seriousness of the applicant towards the reliability of his results. So the next fifth part of planning a research proposal is experimental design and work plan. So the experimental design, we can have design the experimental work, dividing it into a major events and sub events, and it is always nice to be associated with the realistic and sufficient timelines. And also one should not shy away from mentioning the risk factors. For example, particular method or technique may not work down the line in the experiments. So one should mention such possible risk factors, and also it is nice to include some alternative strategies for the same. So these are all indicate your forthrightness and how really you have planned your research project. So another important aspect is the clear milestones. So the clear milestones are nothing but they are the indicators of completion of particular steps in the experimental plan. So this will also give very nice idea for the reviewers to track whether the project is progressing enough in a manner which was planned. So finally, including a flow diagram which explains and summarizes the entire work plan is also considered by the reviewers as an important part, because they can quickly capture as a snapshot what actually the research proposal is being considered like. So beforehand, the last part which we can include in project proposal planning is giving a thought about what are the major resources required for carrying out this proposed work. So the funding bodies expects the realistic planning of the budget, and as we know, the major chunks of funds are required for consumables and experimental animals. And I guess this section, the India Alliance has different programs and the different and they are with different limits of fundings. I guess that will be covered in the next session. So after adequate planning, this is about effective writing of a research proposal. So as we all know, writing is an important part, and it is often being said that a bad writing can destroy the success of a good research problem. So one should give the importance which is more essential for writing part also, apart from planning the research proposal. So some of the hints include like, so knowing the mission and goal statement of a funding agency. So it is said that if it is possible, one has to borrow some of the keywords like mission and goal statements, keywords from these statements of funding agency into their application. And also these days, most of the funding agency, including India Alliance and DST and DBT, they are providing a specific grant application structure. So, but one if feels that there is something important, there is always a room to include and bring it to the knowledge of reviewers. So our writing should be always directed to a technical person who is not expert in our field. And there are word limits which are a fair number. So it is possible to restrict ourselves into the in the word limit which is mentioned. And also it is often said that the preliminary data to support the research proposal is important. But as per my knowledge, the early career fellowships, since this is not mandatory. So if at all the preliminary data is available, that is very nice. And let the reviewers know that some work has been done and also may be taken in positive way. But it is not always possible to have the preliminary data if the person is newly starting any research project. So some of the other tips which help in effective writing of a research proposal is, so it is better to have a outline of with the headings and subheadings for the research proposal in the beginning, and later on we can fill out each and every section whenever we get the information. So, and as we know, most of the time we borrow, take information from the available literature and resources, but it is always important to be original in our writing. So we should put our own statements, even though the information is from other resources. So at the same time, instead of long and indirect sentences, complex sentences, it is better to use direct and simple sentences. So one important thing is to highlight the key points. And it is often being said that the highlighting will help the reviewers for reviewing, meaning the research project will also help the reviewers to prepare their comments and review reports. For example, the key points like the long-term research goal, the rationale, and many other such things can be highlighted, which can be easily picked up by the reviewers. So this is the second section after the research proposal. We are talking about now the biographical sketch and justification for the research proposal. As we know, as I already mentioned, the funding agency gives equal importance to the both research proposal as well as the background of a person or the applicant. So it includes, mostly commonly includes the summary of education and professional history. So since the CV or the biographical sketch develops over a period of time, so we cannot change in overnight And so the most important point is we should present our biographical sketch in a manner that will support our research proposals. So the key points are that it should reflect that I am able to do an independent work, and I also have a track record in research field.
Dr. Sajjadar,
motivated.
Sorry to interrupt you.
Such contributions. And they ask it of a personal state. Hello.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt you. Hello? You were breaking down a little bit. Your voice was not clear. Can you just repeat the section?
Okay. From which this one is?
Which slide can you tell me? Slide. From the last slide?
This one?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. So, sorry for the disturbance. Am I audible now?
Yes, you are audible now.
Yeah. I was telling that the funding agency not only look for the research proposal per se, but they also give a equal importance to the applicant's background. So this is the place where our biographical sketch or CV plays an important role. So as we all know, the biographical sketch of any person develops over a period of time. And I guess within the available information, we should present it in such a way that it should supplement the research proposal. So most important points are like it should indicate that I am independent, I can do an independent work, and also it should reflect my track record in the research field. So the India Alliance asks a biographical sketch in the form of a scientific career to date, where we can write by answering some of the questions such as what motivated me to pick up the research field, and how my career progressed, and what are the some of the achievements, key achievements and awards which I have till date, and also what are the specific research contributions in terms of publications if the applicant is having, and if they are related to the proposed proposal, they should be mentioned. So some other funding agency also require in the form of biographical sketch as a personal statement. They expect that to justify how we are uniquely qualified for the proposed work, and also if I have any specific method experience to the method as well as a technique which is proposed in the proposal. So some of the flags one should take care that the research proposal as such should not be repeated in the personal statement, and also one should not include any non-relevant information, because the section the education and the employment history is already mentioned. one should not repeat it in the personal statement. So again, the scientific contributions are asked as a part of biographical sketch, where we can briefly describe our previous research work and also highlight the publications or the URLs which we have done previously. So there is always a balance in writing a personal statement and scientific contribution, that one should not be sound more bragging or too modest. So one should maintain a balance or take a help of some of the friends or senior colleagues to read your personal statement and scientific contribution section of your grant application. So apart from biographical sketch, the funding agency may ask some of the justifications for the research proposal. For example, the India Alliance asked to justify the host institution. So how the host institution is complementing your proposed work, and also if any lacunae are there in the host institution, and that you can also say that there is an option of work outside host institution, which one can mention that this part of work I would carry out in outside host institution. So, and there is also another justification. So it also asks for how you utilize the grant as a platform for attaining a independent research career. This is the most common for the early career research fellowship and also maybe in other programs. So it essentially asks how you utilize the funding to train new young researchers or furthering your research career. So after these two sections, now I briefly mention what are the resources available for preparing an effective grant application. So I have written some of them here. The first one is the National Institute of Health, which the website of NIH reflects many resources for on the grant application. And one important thing which I observed, which I was not knowing earlier, is the availability of this RO1 grants. They are the successful RO1 grants which are available for free download. So we can download those successful grants and see how they are structured and take some of the key factors for making the application effective. At the same time, the National Science Foundation also features some of the resources and also grant conferences which we can refer to. The major universities also have a grant section in their website, which will also help us to take some of the points. So in another one nice resource is Elsewhere's Research Academy. I guess many of us may be knowing that also includes some of the resources like, you know, how to secure early career research funding and funding hacks for researchers, and also some of the presentations which we can take benefit of. So one more important point I want to highlight, that is the India Alliance videos. So whatever resources I mentioned, the previous resources I was not aware of earlier. So, but I extensively relied myself on the India Alliance videos. So in these videos, they are posted on the India Alliance website. And in these websites, some of the successful fellows and also esteemed committee members explain how to prepare a research project and how to attain your fellowships. So they were very helpful, and I guess maybe they will help many more while preparing their application. So this is the last section of my talk. So here I would like to briefly tell about my personal experiences of applying to the India Alliance Early Career Fellowship. So I came to know about the India Alliance programs from one of my colleagues. And to be honest, there are many starting hitches for me to apply for this fellowship. So when the call was announced, I was just transferred from my previous institute, National Institute of Abiotic Stress Management near Pune. And I was newly joined in the IVRI, and it was a bit of confusion for submitting the proposal. At the same time, another point was I found the India Alliance fellowships as very competitive and prestigious. When I look back, some of the previous awardees, they had a postdoc experience in some reputed labs, and also some of them, most of them were from abroad, and also they had high impact publications. So I was in dilemma whether my research background is well enough to apply for these programs. But nevertheless, I did my research PhD work in animal viruses, and I had a couple of good publications. I thought, why not to try once? So and another aspect was, since I did my PhD research work in animal viruses, but in my earlier posting in the previous institute, which I mentioned now, I also worked on some of the abiotic stress research problems in animals. So I was again in confusion which research topic to choose. So all these starting hitches were there. So I just mentioned here, I got a excellent support from my supervisor, Dr. Ravi Kumar sir, and also Dr. B.P. Mishra sir, who were there in my host institute. They motivated me and also helped me to choose and plan the research work. And I would say their help was a major boost in submitting the application to this India Alliance Fellowship. So after submitting the preliminary application, the full application was asked, and I found the full application process like a very structured and detailed. So it was from the beginning itself, it was very engaging and rigorous, and it provided an opportunity for meticulous planning. Rather, it forced me to plan on each and every aspect of my research proposal. So to say here, I submitted my project on the one of the small ruminant virus, that is PPRV virus. So I try to plan the research project by taking each aspect which I mentioned earlier, like starting from the long-term research goal to identifying the key research questions, and what is my hypothesis and experimental plans, and what are the major budgetary requirements. So I had a couple of discussions and feedback from my senior colleagues here, and it also improved my interpersonal skills. So time to time I had a great support from India Alliance staff over some of the points. All in all, it was a very good learning experience on how to write a grant application. As we know, the grant application, we can listen to many talks and also webinars or even presentations and attend the conferences on grant writing. But the real learning comes from when one is put through the process of submitting the grant. So I would say I learned some of the grant application skills. I feel I am a little bit better than before applying to this fellowship program. So the after full application stage, I was shortlisted for interview, and one of the point is that I found the reviewing the application by the India Alliance, the process is very excellent in the sense. So I got the reviewer's comments to my full application, and it was very detailed of about 10 pages, and my application was reviewed very thoroughly, in the sense that there were many critical comments also and suggestions to improve, and there was no need to submit the justification for the reviewer comments. But still, as a matter of preparation, I prepared all possible justification and answers to the reviewer comments. And the interview format is like a 5-minute short talk, and followed by discussion with the committee members, which may run up to 30 to 40 minutes. So for preparing for the interview, I prepared a script and also did a mock interview with my friends and senior colleagues, including my supervisor. So on the day of interview, as usual, I was a bit nervous, but I again highlight here the support from the India Alliance grant advisor, who was there at that place, and he was a great support. And when I entered in the interview hall, there was a committee members of 15 to 20 who are all eminent researchers sitting around the round table. And after my 5-minute short talk, they were very welcoming, and the discussion went on from starting from my research proposal to entire part of it. So there was a discussion on each and every section, and each of them were very supportive. So I felt it was a nice experience. So one cannot ask for more when such senior researchers are talking about your research proposal and nudging you to give explanation and also offering possible solutions. So overall, it was one of the best experience in my research career to have such an interview. So after an interview, I was luckily awarded, and this is a matter of a satisfaction or a sense of accomplishment, but at the same time, it is a great responsibility for the funding agency, and the reviewers have reposed a faith in you. And till now, the award process is very smooth because of the excellent support from the India Alliance staff, and as well as the very flexible funding process. So the take-home message is the India Alliance funding represents an excellent opportunity for life science scientists in India. And I would like to mention that our animal and veterinary science represents an important area of life science, and our problems are more of significance and have an impact, especially as they deal with the field problems of our animal agriculture. And I suppose that India Alliance also wants to diversify their funding portfolio, and there is always a chance or a greater opportunity in availing the India Alliance funding. And I hope most of our colleagues in working in the animal science area would take this opportunity and try to apply for India Alliance fellowships. So with this, I acknowledge the India Alliance for supporting me through early career fellowship, and also my host institute, Indian Veterinary Research Institute, and also my mentors, supervisors. Finally, I thank the organizers of this webinar for giving me an opportunity. And I will also say thank for all of you for patient listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sajjanar, for a very, very comprehensive presentation on grants writing and what entails the skills included in grants writing. We have time for a couple of questions before we start the second session, where we will discuss in detail the different funding opportunities for researchers in India that India Alliance provides. I would request our audience to type in their questions in the question box, which you can see on your console. You also have a little hand icon that you can hit on if you want to speak. If you want to share your question or you share your comment with us. So one of the questions that we can start with is, Dr. Sajjanar, we would like to know a little bit more about your research, about the work you are doing under the project that is funded by India Alliance.
Yeah. So am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. So as I said in the beginning, I did my PhD work on animal viruses like rabies virus and infectious bursal disease virus. So for my early career fellowship, I have taken up a problem on one of the important animal virus, that is Peste des petits ruminant virus, which is considered as a plague in case of sheep and goat. So even though the vaccine is available for this disease, but there are several virulent strains which are circulating in the field. So my research problem talks about the pathogenic mechanism of the virulent strain vis-a-vis with the vaccine strain, which is developed by our own host institute. So if I found some of the pathogenic mechanisms that not only adds to the basic part of the problem, but also we can improve the vaccines and also some of the diagnostic techniques. So as I mentioned, the problem is considered to be significant because of the lot of the small ruminants are being affected. So this is about my this is about my early career research project which I am undertaking now.
Thank you for sharing your plans, research plans with us and your work with us. Another important question that has come up quite many times today is that when you are just starting out your career as a researcher, as an independent researcher after PhD, how do you go about in choosing a research question and looking for funding for that research question? Would you like to share some advice and tips with our audience?
Yeah, it's always depends upon the career of a person. So in my case, I was immediately selected for ARS after the PhD. So I was looking for not for personal support rather, but I was very much interested to obtain some of the research grants for the research project. So it may differ from person to person. One who is doing a postdoc and want to establish his own independent lab, then the India Alliance is the best because it supports not only the, it gives not only the personal support, but also it provides generous funding for the research project itself. So it depends on the person to person. And I guess one should start looking for the funding opportunity when they're about to submit their PhD thesis itself. So it would be like even the person goes for postdoc, the planning for a research grant never go waste. So in any case, one who has decided to stay in a research career, so then if I have a plan for funding, so whenever the opportunity comes, that will always be a helpful one. Meaning, so when I am ready, but with a research problem at my hand, so as and when opportunity comes, one can apply. So again, for early career researchers, the India Alliance is the best suited because it immediately after the, even the person who is yet to submit the PhD also can submit the application. But again, there are caveats because the India Alliance, as I think the next session may tell about it. So only once opportunity, once a person unable to secure a funding in early career, he may not be able to apply. So the meticulous planning is also required when to apply. But I guess one should start thinking about the research project and grant application maybe immediately after completing the PhD, even one may go for postdoc application. But whenever the opportunity comes, he can apply. So I think this is the best way, I guess, in my opinion.
Yeah, thank you. I remember from your slides that you had put up a slide about power analysis of hypothesis. And I think people from our audience want to know a little more about that, or if you can direct them to some resources where they can read it up.
Yeah, I guess, as I mentioned there, most of the funding agencies explicitly mention how you justify the sample size in your experimental plan. So it is all about the reliability of the results which you get in a research project. So if your experiment really involves the taking the data points and animal experiments and such things, so one should always explain in the research plan about how they have how they justify their sample size. So I think many of the life scientists, including me, may not be very much expert in the statistics field, but nevertheless, one should always one should always try to include the power calculation and hypothesis testing. So I think many resources are available. So maybe I, as I also mentioned, so consulting any statistician in your institute or in nearby is also a worthy point, you know.
Yes, absolutely. I think consulting a statistician in your when you plan your research is an important advice. There is a comment from someone that it was very informative presentation, and somehow many during their career do not pay much attention to writing their own CV or write or to their writing their own bios. And can you share a few tips on what is it that people reviewers look for when they are looking at your career trajectory?
Yeah, I guess again, I'm as I mentioned, so the CV develops over a period of time. So it's better to be a consistent performer than it comes to a help when it is required. For example, the one should try out when he is doing a graduation, for example, in the PhD, which is considered as a graduate studies abroad. But when as a student, as well as immediately in immediate career, one should try out his best to apply for some of the awards and also some of the conferences and try to publish their research work. So the CV is developed over a period of time. So hence one should be consistent. So then it will come to a handy whenever we want to present our CV to a funding agency. But nevertheless, so even if we don't have high impact factor papers, but one is having a even single study which reflects that he is capable to do the research, I guess that makes the point. So the reviewers may not be very much behind the high impact publication or some very prestigious awards, but if the CV itself says that you can do the research work and it suffices, I guess. But as I said, the CV develops over a period of time. If one somebody wants to plan, so they should be consistent. Like one has to try for all the some of the awards or some of the publications. So they should be consistent. So that may help, I guess.
Yes, thank you very much for that very important advice. Here's a question from the audience. Sometimes there is a perception that research in animal sciences or animal health may not be considered as competitive as research in human health, it may not be considered competitive enough when compared to research problems pertaining to human health. What are your thoughts about this, and especially how can we make our the grant proposals on animal science and animal health more competitive in such a scenario?
Yeah, I think this is the most of the perception of ours, including me. We have this perception that most of the time the basic research gets funding, and we fall in the somewhere between the basic and applied research. But I guess it's about how we connect our problem. So how we state the impact and the significance of our research problem, and what are our the long-term effect. So for example, in my case, I sufficiently made clear that it's not about the basic work. So the basic aspect also included my application. For example, we want to find some of the unknown basic things, but at the same time, how it improves the life of, for example, farming community. So I guess we should not be so much, thinking about our problem may not be so basic, but at the same time, so if we are able to show the importance and the significance, and also show that the problem which we are pursuing is worth enough, you know. So it's not only the basic work which is funded, but it's fair enough to say that we should try ourselves, so before coming to a conclusion, I guess that's my take on that.
Thank you. I think we have time for one last question now before we start the second session on the funding opportunities that India Alliance provides. So I know that you have shared a couple of tips about how to prepare for an interview, especially for the India Alliance interview, the face-to-face interview. But are there any other advices that you would like to share with our audience that can help us to face any such interview where they need to defend their research proposal?
Yeah, I think as far as India Alliance is concerned, the preparation itself is such a thorough one, in the sense that it starts with a preliminary application and a full application and then interview. By the time interview, you are so shaped up yourself, in you can answer most of the questions, so you will become more confident. But there is a last minute, the nervousness will be there. But in case of India Alliance, I guess it was a very nice experience. So it was not at all apprehensive type of interaction. So I think the preparation is best is like, you know, try ourselves, write a script and give a lot of mock interviews. Any interview, one should try to prepare a script. So because most of these type of interviews will have a specific time limit. So if one is already prepared and tried a mock interview, which will really help. I think in my case, I exactly finished at five minutes and the discussion followed. So I guess I think it's a support from the committee members also matters. But all in all, one key point is prepare a script and also do a mock interview in front of your seniors or mentors several times, in the sense, so until you get it right. No, I think that was my experience.
Thank you. With that, we come to the end of our first session. I thank you, Dr. Sajjanar, for a very comprehensive talk and a very informative presentation. I am sure that your advice will help our audience to prepare well for their research, to present their research proposals and to write their grants. We will now start on with our second session. And before we begin that session, I would request our audience to take a second poll, to participate in the second poll. This will help us to, I think, share the funding opportunities in a better way with you. Yes, so please answer this poll. So again, we have a very mixed opinion here. I think 20% of our audience say that they know about the India Alliance funding programs. But 47% of our audience do not know, and 33% know somewhat about the programs of India Alliance. Thank you for taking that poll. One last announcement before we say bye for today. You will be redirected to a feedback or a survey page as the webinar closes. I request you to please fill up and submit the feedback form. It will help us to enhance these engagements and to be able to come up with better programs for you. Again, I would like to thank you for being a fantastic audience today. We had a very good time at these sessions and hope you did too. Do visit our website for more information. And if you have any further questions, do reach out to us. You can always write to us at info@indiaalliance.org. With that, bye, and please take good care of yourself. Thank you. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.